Hey G.I. Joe fans, Joe Motion Videos 82 here. It is time for another G.I. Joe toy review. And hey, it is on time. Wow. I mean, this new schedule has really thrown me off for some reason. Off Sunday through Wednesday, but I spend part of the day Sunday sleeping. Right after church, and then I'm up most of the night and sleep in on Monday. Then that just leaves me a Tuesday and Wednesday and trying to catch up with everything. But I think I got it worked out now. So I'll just try this schedule. I'm not going to make any promises. My gosh, it sucks working at night. It really, really throws everything off. I mean, not just planning things like this, but one day after the next, you know, I work 3 days in a row, so I'm actually going home and coming to work the same day that I leave. I leave at 6 a.m., then I go back to work at 6 p.m., so it's actually the same day, leave and go back the same day that I work. So I leave on a Thursday, you get it. You know, if it's a Thursday, I go in at 6 p.m. and get out on Friday. Then I come back on Friday at 6 a.m. and come back at 6 p.m. You know, it really throws the day off. So you go to sleep and your brain is naturally telling you it's a new day, but really it's the same day. If it wasn't for the calendar, I wouldn't know what day it is. I just can't keep track. Okay, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, like I used to on a normal person's schedule. But thanks to the Industrial Revolution and the miracle of the light bulb, people work at night now. Dang you, Thomas Edison, and anybody else who tried to think of a light bulb. You have really screwed things up. But I couldn't imagine doing my job with a lantern or a flashlight, especially a lantern, you know, a gas or any flame lantern with working around oxygen. I mean, you're just asking for trouble. But I do carry a flashlight with me. That way I'm not waking my patients up when I go into a room at night. Carry a little light on my clipboard, little book light, so that's dim enough to where I could still see, but I'm not waking people up. And I have a flashlight as well if I need to look for something down on the floor or look for an outlet or something. That way I'm not turning a light on, waking people up. So there are good things that came from the light bulb. So anyway, history lesson over. We're talking about G.I. Joe, aren't we? Yes, we are. That's what this channel is about. We're going to be taking a trip back to 1990. Wow, my freshman year of high school. Out here at the time in Arizona, junior high was 7, 8, and 9. Grades 7, 8, and 9. So I was technically a freshman, but I was still in junior high. It was really weird. So being technically a high school student, if we had a learner's permit, we were allowed to ride you could get a special license to ride a scooter or a motorcycle, but we couldn't park it on campus. We had to park it across the street if you were 14. And there was this one kid that did that, and he was the envy of the whole school. You weren't allowed to park it on campus because the school wasn't insured for that, but you could park it across the street. So that's what he did. And you know, it was pretty cool, you know, seeing that guy, you know, coming up on his little Honda scooter, boom, boom, you pull it up on the sidewalk and park it, and then, you know, cross the road over to the school. So that kind of became a spectacle for a little bit until the novelty of it wore off. I think his name was Todd, something like that, Todd Christensen. something of that nature. But could be wrong though. You know, it's been quite a few years. 33 years. But anyway, so 1990, yes, I was in my freshman year of high school, and yes, I was still collecting G.I. Joe. Pathfinder was one that I kind of passed up on. It was by the 90s, they were really starting to over accessorize all the G.I. Joes, all the action figures. I mean, they came with a ton of accessories, and if they had too many accessories, I didn't want them, but if they had just enough, I wanted them. But if he was cool and had a lot of accessories, I wanted it. You know, so I was just going by the card art and what the action figure looked like. But this one, the card art didn't really impress me, neither did the action figure. So I passed him up, and having him now, I really wish I would have bought him. This would have been cool to have. But being 14, I wasn't playing with G.I. Joe, so to speak, as I had mentioned in other videos. At this time, I had friends that were younger, you know, by 1 or 2 years, and they were still playing with toys, so they would come over and play with G.I. Joe, and I'd kind of sit there and, you know, just talk as they played, or I would play a little bit along with them. But mostly I displayed them, or my younger brother would play with them. But he has so many tiny accessories, I'm sure they would have been lost. And to find him complete these days, I'm not saying it's rare, but I mean, that was a feat in humility for, or I shouldn't say humility, but just protecting your toys, taking good care of your toys, to find this guy complete. And I'll point that out when we look at this guy. Is he came with some tiny, tiny accessories that I just would have easily been lost. And I know for a fact that if I were a kid, I would not have played with them, because they're just too, it's just too much, too cumbersome, and I would have just thrown it out. But my memory of this guy, I do remember going to Kmart. The closest Kmart to our house at the time was in Apache Junction, Arizona. It's kind of a historical little town. It's along the what we call the Apache Trail. It was, according to history, was a trail that the Apaches would take, the Apache Indians would take, to travel across the state. And then when it gets into Phoenix, it turns into Apache Boulevard, but it's Apache Trail. The further east you go, so this goes through Apache Junction, and then you could jump on an interstate or a highway that'll take you into Canyon Lake, which was the closest lake out there, or up into the historical Apache, or the Superstition Mountains, where the Lost Dutchman gold mine was. So Apache Trail was the main street for Arizona for a very, very long time. So naturally they're going to put a Kmart on there. So I remember going into this Kmart, and off to the left as you walk in, of course, there's the customer service desk right when you walk in, then the cashier's desks, or the checkout, are off to the left, and then they had a snack bar that was off to the right, and then that's where all the clothes were. Then off to the left was the garden department, tools, and the toy department. So naturally, as I walked in, boom, off to the left all the time, off to the left, off to the left, to go to the toys. I remember Pathfinder being there. And I looked at him and was like, no, I don't really like it. The card art was cool to a degree, but I looked at his weapon and it's like, this dude comes with a weed eater. Okay. No, it was just too far-fetched and ridiculous for me, so I didn't buy him. And I think I opted for the Iron Grenadier that came out prior. That I think that's the one that I selected, but don't quote me on that one. They came out in what, 88? So yeah, he still would have been on the pegs. But anyway, Pathfinder was released in 1990, and he was discontinued domestically in 91. So 1990 was the year that, for those of you wondering, 1990 was the year where they started to only do a limited run of 1 year instead of the 2 years. Or at the very early stages of G.I. Joe, they would run it for 3 or 4, give kids a chance to catch up. So yeah, you only had a year to get this. So I know they flooded the market with these to get as much money out of the production, out of to re recoup their cost of manpower and all that. So anyway, yeah, he came out in 1990. He came with machine guns, ammo belt, a backpack, your quintessential G.I. Joe plastic hose that replaced the wire. And it does say right on the bot, right here in the description, weed eater. Yeah. Pathfinder is actually a branch of the U.S. Army. I believe they came about in World War II. Their exact job, I don't know, but I have a feeling, let me check that real quick for you guys. Okay, so the Pathfinders, since I had brought it up, they deserve to have that part of their history mentioned. I don't want to leave that part out because this is pretty important. I don't want to discredit them, let's put it that way. They're not, it wasn't just an action figure. These guys are a branch of the military, that the U.S. Army, that started in 1943 until present time. They're kind of pseudo special forces, in my opinion. It says here the U.S. Army, United States Army Pathfinder School trains personnel in the U.S. Army and its sister services to set up parachute drop zones and helicopter landing zones for airborne and air assault missions. So, I mean, these guys, I mean, they're putting themselves out there first in line. Possibly, I shouldn't say possibly, but I'm sure that they do face the enemy on some of these missions, or most of them, to set up these landing zones and drop zones. And they gather all the information or intel and send it all back to their base and say, okay, this spot is a good spot to land. We have it cleared. So that would explain why he has a weed eater to blaze a path, a good landing zone for helicopters. And that would be more of a covert thing. I mean, they're not necessarily quiet, but I'm sure they would just use detonation cord and blow down trees if they had to. But they want this to be as covert as possible, so I could understand the weed eater tool. Just that alone would explain it. But if any of you have served in the Pathfinders, thank you very much for doing that. And please, share in the comments what your part of the job was. I'm very interested to know. I only met one person who was in the Pathfinders, and he didn't talk about it much. He just said that he had served in Desert Storm and just left it at that. He didn't want to talk about his military service outside of the fact that he stayed in for his 20 years, and finally he said his CO said, "You've been living off of Uncle Sam long enough. Go home," and discharged him. So apparently he was an aide to his commanding officer from the way he talked about things. But there was only three versions of this action figure. So I'll pull up pictures of the card art as well as pictures of the action figures. But there was a three pack that was in the UK that was released in 1992. It came packaged with Bullhorn and Night Creeper. And all of their original accessories. So this guy, it's pretty cool to see that he came in a three pack. As we seldom saw those here in the States. They started with the release of the G.I. Joe movie, where they had Globulus, Nepheus, Enforcer, and the Royal Guard that came in a three pack, and Slaughter's Renegades that came in a three pack. So it then later on it was Battle Force 2000 that came in a multi-pack. So it was neat seeing those in the three packs, and or a multi-pack, I should say. So let me go ahead and pull those up. All right, so you can see the different versions of Pathfinder, the gray version that came out in 2001, and then we didn't see another one until 2016, where it came back in his original design and original colors, I should say. And that's kind of a shame. It's really, you're doing the research on this action figure and understanding the job of what the Pathfinders do. I mean, he's kind of an essential character, if you really want to play in a real world military scenario, which I'm starting to understand that a lot of us did as children, that we would play in real scenarios. So having somebody as a Pathfinder, yeah, he would go out there, you know, ahead of everybody, and you know, find landing zones and, you know, blaze a trail, sort of, to get our troops in there, to get the Joes into an area where Cobra was at. I'm sure they directed the landing zones as, or directed the troops as they were dropping in, you know, saying, you know, this is where you need to go, and stayed there and made sure everything was okay. So yeah, you guys are pretty special. And I'm warning about all of this, and as you guys are, and you know, it's really neat. I wish the only that guy that I would had mentioned would have talked more about his job, but I didn't want to press the issue because he seemed to be pretty upset when I would ask him about his military career, not to try to pry stories out of him, but to you know, show my appreciation. So he, like most soldiers that face combat, were facing post-traumatic stress. So I didn't want to push it. If I get a sense of, hey, let's stop, I stop. I'm just learning from experience with my dad about the war. So you know, had the Pathfinders, but there's also a branch of the U.S. military that are meteorologists. I learned this off the History Channel, that they'll go out to areas that they plan to check out and send meteorologists ahead of everybody and get weather patterns that are going to be there. So, you know, they definitely don't want to land in the middle of a snowstorm or middle of a rainstorm or a sandstorm. They want the weather conditions to be as friendly as possible is to not hamper any of their objectives. So G.I. Joe did not ever, or Hasbro did not ever come out with a meteorologist. Why not? You had a Pathfinder, why not the meteorologist? So the original retail price on this guy was $2.55. Not bad. We might not be to find him for $2.55 complete. That would be you would need a Pathfinder to find one. I did find one loose without any accessories at a used bookstore for $4.99, which is not bad, for a single loose action figure. But I doubt you'll ever find one again complete for that price. Even that three pack that was released to UK was $6.98 or £6.98. So I mean, but that was for three action figures. I mean, yeah, but given for inflation and everything, I would expect these prices to be high. So that brings us into my favorite segment, Byron's Gripes. Yes, Byron's Gripes. For those of you who are just joining, sorry for being so verbose. I like to give a little bit of history at the beginning of each of these reviews, or to talk about my childhood experiences with these toys. And I found that a lot of viewers enjoy that, and it helps them remember. And I enjoy reminiscing. Who doesn't? But I started Byron's Gripes as a way to educate people on the prices. If you're just starting out collecting, it helped me to know what was a good price and what wasn't. And I would, shoot HTC an email. Hey, I'm looking at this figure. Is this a good price? And he'd say yes or no. There are a lot of them out there, so search for a better price, or no, grab it. That's a great price for it. So Brian, thank you again for that. That was a big help for me. So that is where Byron's Gripes really came from. But why do I call it gripes? Well, some of these prices are just outlandish. There are many, many sites out there that do sell vintage toys, that do sell G.I. Joe, and all the sites are great. I have no problem with the sites. I use eBay as a reference only. That is it. I don't pick on eBay. I don't pick on its sellers. You will not find bullying on this channel. I am anti-bully 100%. I was bullied as a kid. I was seen as the nerd, and finally nerds are popular. They're prevailing. It's about time. People thought I was smart, or I didn't dress cool like the rest of the kids, so I got picked on. And of course, I was very tall and very thin, and that was enough alone to be picked on. I remember my early adult years, I only weighed 155 pounds. I mean, I was a steady 155 up into my 30s, and I 6 foot six, 155 pounds. I looked like a walking skeleton, and people called me Jack Skellington, and I kind of took that as a compliment after Nightmare Before Christmas came out. And then I started putting on weight after that. Now I'm close to 300 pounds now, and that's not healthy. I remember at one time when they were saying being a little heavy was healthy, but actually it's not. You have an ideal body weight. I'm above mine, so I got to get back down to my ideal body weight just for simple cardiovascular health. So anyway, we're not talking about health either. We're talking about G.I. Joe. So yes, I will not ever pick on the sellers. I will not mention who they are and say, you suck. Why are you doing this? No, the prices I do pick on. I do wonder why in the world is this so expensive when there are so many toys out there? And especially the ones that say rare. No, it's just a tagline. It's not rare. Believe you me, it is not rare. Unless you import it from another country, then it's rare here in the United States, but not in other countries that did have G.I. Joe, Action Force, so on and so forth. So anyway, getting started here, we have one that comes with a card, a full card back that has been cut. It looks like they took the flag points off of it and cut the file card off. With some accessories, $37.99. That is not bad, actually. I will put that up with deal of the day, because the accessories are fairly inexpensive. Here is one incomplete. It's missing a few of the accessories. It's missing the backpack and the two machine guns. Why am I doing Byron's Gripes right now? We haven't even looked at the action figure. All right. Well, let's look at the action figure. All right, so here he is. Here's Pathfinder. Just looking at him, he's kind of an interesting looking figure. Let's start off with his file card here. It's Pathfinder, Jungle Assault Specialist. You can see here that he's wearing the Vietnam era jungle boots. The bottom part was leather, and the rest of it was made from canvas. The rest of the boot was, but his pants are not bloused in his boots. They go over the top, which is pretty interesting. Jungle Assault Specialist. His file name is Ianotti William V. Serial number 049812. JA41, primary military specialty jungle assault specialist. So he kind of took over the role of Rakondo. Secondary military specialty, forward observer and recon. Birthplace Key West, Florida. He is an E6. So his middle paragraph reads, by growing up in alligator infested swamplands and Southern Florida, Pathfinder quickly learned how to find his way around in order to stay alive. With his father's help, Pathfinder mastered the ways of jungle survival, which, you know, Florida is in some areas a jungle. Pretty interesting, you know, a lot of swamp area. He learned how to make trails and were there, trails where there were none, and detect unnatural jungle sounds and to attack unsuspecting targets swiftly and quietly. When he was 18, Pathfinder enlisted in the U.S. Army and began his career as jungle recon specialist. Almost immediately, became the Army's premier jungle rainforest tactical assault expert. Pathfinder was then ordered to serve as G.I. Joe Jungle Assault Specialist, where he is now responsible for all covert operations involving jungle attacks on Cobra Island. Okay, so he was made to. Okay, usually he's recruited, but there was also another jungle specialist that came out around this time as well, but we'll eventually get to him. But bottom paragraph reads, and in a quote, we could be chest deep in midnight swamp with mosquitoes in our ears, leeches in our boots, and cobra night vipers firing up our trails with tracers. But as long as Pathfinder has the point, we'll come out smelling like roses. I hope so, after wading through stagnant water. He learned everything from his father and decorated reconnaissance grunt from the Korean War. Like his father, he doesn't know the meaning of the word surrender. When Pathfinder leads a jungle patrol, he does not stop until the job is successfully completed and all objectives have been accomplished, and I mean all objectives. So okay, this guy does not know when to quit, and that's what you need when you're out there. You need that attitude of we just can't stop, we have to finish. The H1 down here in the corner, that usually pops up, or always pops up, on the second run of the file card. Before, they would have different colored file cards, but then they start putting the H1 down there in the corner. You know, you'd have like a peach or a pink file card, then it would be a different hue after that. So let's go ahead and look at Pathfinder's accessories here. First, he comes with a weed eater. This could also be a secondary weapon. I would have used it as such. The grip is way too thick. It's way too thick to put in his hand, so I do not want to force it in through his hands. But the blade did come separately, so you had to spread the head of the weed eater apart to put the blade in. But it does rotate, which I think is pretty cool. So this was an accessory that did work. It came with this hose, and the hose would attach right to the backpack. I'm sure this is a backpack full of fuel to power the weed eater. So as you can see, that this is all the accessories on here. This is why I passed him up at first. This backpack is pretty cool, very mechanical looking. Has a power source, I guess, and the fuel, however you want to play with it as. And here he has ammo belts that are made out of a soft plastic that feed right into this, so it could be an ammo drum as well, whatever your imagination could come up with. So it's a silver soft plastic. You'd see that there is ammunition on here. When I first saw this, I thought these were saw blades, and then when I started going on Yojo and looking at it, I was like, wait a second, you know, this is these are ammo belts, but they clip right here on the bottom of the backpack. As you can see, there are pegs here. Be careful, these pegs are pretty thin, so they might snap off fairly with ease, so you know, be careful. Those go on real easily, and then they snap right onto the gun. The two guns that are attached to his waist. So they stick out as such, and his arms are a little too short to hold on to the guns. So let's go ahead and take a look at one of those. They peg right onto the side here. He has those little notches, and the gun has the little slot there. It's kind of a ball hinge where it attaches. They're identical. There is a left and a right gun. Absolutely not. So it doesn't matter which side goes on which. You could just flip them right on over. You could see they're vented barrels, and very cool looking. I like that idea of him having those two guns, but that would be pretty heavy to be carrying on your waist, and having to carry this heavy backpack going through a jungle. You would just sink right into the mud. So I don't envy that man at all. So I'm sure he would determine the terrain and what weapons to carry. So he is a kind of a serious looking dude there with his sunglasses. Kind of looks like Larry Hama in a way. He is wearing a boonie hat, a brown vest, kind of caramel color, over a black shirt. So I would take that as being a canvas vest, sort of like a fishing vest would be. He has his sleeves rolled up. Not the only Joe that came with a black shirt. Flint did too. Black BDUs, done in this caramel and green camouflage. This is pretty cool. I didn't think so back then, but these days I think it is pretty cool. I like that camo pattern on there. And of course his gun attachment, which is attached to the belt around his waist. I mean, just thinking about that in reality, I would not want to be carrying that. I mean, just imagine how cumbersome that would be to walk around with these two guns and they're sticking out in front of you or dangling at your side, getting hung up on foliage. No. I mean, it's a good idea. It's a cool looking toy, but in reality, no, not really. Black boots, of course, and then his sunglasses that he's wearing. He could pose as a fisherman. Be up there with Bazooka, both out there in the middle of the jungle in a raft, pretending to be fishermen. And Bazooka version 3, I think that is. Yeah, I mean, he's a cool action figure to look at and to set up all these accessories. I just love. But from a practical standpoint, no. I mean, the Weed Eater is pretty silly. HCC, when he reviewed it, he parodied the Weed Eater in a little skit that he would do on his videos. Yeah, I mean, the backpack I could do without, and these really heavy guns. Just give him the Weed Eater with the backpack, a rifle, and I would have been fine, or a machete, which would have been pretty appropriate for him. But all of that, all these little extra bells and whistles, practically, I don't like it, but as an action figure, as a toy, aesthetically, it is pretty cool to look at and certainly to play with. So that is a first for this channel. My gosh. Usually I am a lot more attentive. Go from one segment to the next, go through, talk about the figure, show the figure, go to Byron's Gripes, and then close. So I left that in as a gaffe. I just couldn't help myself. That was just too rich. So it just goes to show you I do this kind of sort of live. But I do not have enough followers yet, enough subscribers to do a live stream. You have to have at least 1,000. So I am reaching what I want to reach 700 by the end of the year. And when I do get 700 subscribers, one of these Ram Cycles will be yours. I will be holding a giveaway for everybody. So here we go. So I had aforementioned Pathfinder by himself, or that came with a cut card back. They are selling, so those are auctions. I won't quote the auction prices because they are so fluid. Unless the auction ended and it sold, I'll tell you what it had sold for. So we have his backpack, his Weed Eater, and both guns for $13.99 or best offer. Another one of the same, $14.95. I think that is just a little bit out there. Yeah, it's a dollar something cheaper, but still, that's pretty expensive. Oh, the one $13.99, it is missing the blades for the Weed Eater. So good luck finding that by themselves. Okay, deal of the day here. There is one carded for $109.99. Here is one complete. Another deal of the day, $27.99. Okay, a lot of these are up for auction. His ammo belts, $13.99. I could see that. They're small and some people just didn't play with them. I know I wouldn't have. So that could be something that's easily lost. Okay, here's one 100% complete with his card, full card back, uncut, $55.86. Deal of the day. One that's incomplete, $19.99. One by himself, $8. Bare bones, no accessories. Another one, $7.99, which is bare bones. Here's one that's missing his ammo belts and looks like the hose for, you know, $12.99 or better offer. Here's another one complete, $32.99, deal of the day. Loose, bare bones, $8.99 or $8.89, pardon me. His backpack, $1.29. Incomplete, $21.95. Here's another bare bones that's marked down by 50%. To $7.49 or better offer. After marking it down that much, I doubt they would take too much off of, just from my experience with having to trying to negotiate a price. A lot of people just will not come off of what they have already, or come down much when they have it marked down like that. Then they have body parts here. I won't go through all of those, but great for customizing or replacing broken parts. Another bare bones, $14.36. Here's one with a full with a file card and just the gun with an ammo belt, $17.95. The weed eater by itself with the blade, $10.99. One machine gun, $17.49. Another one complete with file card, $35.16.99. Bare bones with the file card, $16.99. It's another one that's missing the backpack, one machine gun and a hose, $19.99. Yeah, I've already taken up enough of your time, but there are several pages. I mean, several. I've already gone through three of them, but it looks like there's, you know, five. His full card back, $13. I'll put that with deal of the day. Those are kind of nice to have. Some people decorate with them. Here's another carded $1, $175. A mint on card. But, I mean, I'm on page 9 already. So, Pathfinder, yeah. He's not rare, guys. So, there are several of them out there. So, this one will be very easy to get at a fairly comfortable price to get him complete. And even if you're looking for the accessories or a file card or a full card back, if you're a collector of those. Very inexpensive. So, you know, this guy, I mean, deal of the day everywhere with this, which is pretty cool to see. So there you have it. I won't take up any more of your time, and I do apologize for that outtake there. I just left that in just for the fun of it. But I hope being too verbose hasn't turned any of you guys off. This is an unusual long review. So anyway, you guys, you take care. We'll see you next week for another G.I. Joe toy review. Remember, stay safe. Be kind to everybody. You never know what kind of day somebody is having. Be kind to yourself. Take care of yourself. If you can't take care of yourself, how can you help other people? And especially be kind to animals. They know nothing but unconditional love. So until next week, this is Joe Motion Videos 82 signing off. Bye-bye.